Amani National Congress leader Musalia Mudavadi has today given his State of Nation address few days to Madaraka Day. He said it's sad that corruption has bedeviled our nation, but the executive has been lying to Kenyans that we are headed the right direction.
Good afternoon once again. I wish to thank you for making yourself available, and I want to be able to speak on the 28th of May, just a few days to Madaraka Day. And the significance of this remark is to show that it cannot be business as usual, and it is just a few days to Madaraka Day. So please listen to me very carefully as I make this statement, and we shall also share with you the same on soft copy, so that everybody can have time to reference it once you are doing your detailed reports. This topic, or today's topic, is the state of the nation. Time to face the facts. First, the 56th Madaraka Day will be marked on Saturday this week. Madaraka Day is very significant in the life of our country. Indeed, Madaraka is the mother of Kenya's independence. On this day, slightly over half a century ago, we Kenyans gained internal self-government. This meant that apart from defense, finance, and foreign affairs, the rest of the government was in our own hands. 6 months later, we gained full independence. Whenever we mark occasions like Madaraka Day, it is time to look ourselves honestly in the mirror and admit the truth that we see there. We should not gloss over things and the kinds of political half-truths and untruths as we are fond of doing on these national days. We tend to roll out statistics that suggest the country is doing extremely well. Yet the people cannot see or feel the alleged success in their lives. This is because what the executive tells us about our country is simply not true. The greater part of our Madaraka has been characterized with remarkable misrule and abuse of institutions. The state has been largely dysfunctional, and especially now. Our country seems to be free, to be in a free fall at the behest of robber barons that have invaded government. The truth is finally out. State officers are hiding billions of shillings in official budgets with the express intent to steal them. It is a slap in the face of our self-government. Self-government means that our destiny is in our own hands. When we wrestled independence from the colonial master, the objective was not to run down our country. The intention was to build a thriving nation with equal opportunities. In the words of our national anthem, the founders of our country dreamt of an equitable society of hard-working people. They dreamt of justice as our shield and defender, of unity, peace, and liberty. But most significantly, they had a vision of a hard-working people. Let the fruit of our labor fill every heart with thanksgiving, they said. Today, we are seeing instead the fruit of stealing, filling up a few hearts with arrogance, and the rest of the millions of hearts suffering with suffering and misery. We are seeing a country that is overborrowing so as to satisfy the greedy appetite of a few thieves. To paraphrase the great Mahatma Gandhi, our country is adequately resourced to feed everyone's needs, but it does not have enough resources to feed everyone's greed. Today, the national debt is just shy of 6 trillion Kenya shillings. Most of this money cannot be accounted for. It certainly has not been accounted for. When we ask the government to publish the country's debt portfolio, they give us a deaf ear. How long will this reckless borrowing without accountability go on? The Jubilee government and their partners must now tell Kenyans the true level of the country's indebtedness and the detailed terms and conditions around each debt. Kenyans have a right to know. Time has also come when we must now establish an independent public debt management authority. Please catch this. Time has come when we must now establish an independent public debt management authority. The authority must regulate and manage our present debt and future borrowing. It must move us away from the present arrangement where borrowing is handled as if it is a function of a secret society. In this day and age of open governance, government can no longer behave as if it is a secret society. The famous word, serikali sirikali. And especially not when it is borrowing funds to be repaid by the citizens. There must especially be public participation in the decision to borrow and in deciding what we want to do with the borrowed money. These are just a few of the concerns that President Uhuru Kenyatta must clearly address on this 56th Madaraka Day. When the President gave his State of the Nation address last month in Parliament, he left a lot to be desired. He glossed over issues. He spoke in vague and equivocal terms, painting glossy pictures of a strange, non-existent country. The Head of State's address was a damper that left many of us wondering whether he lives in this country or somewhere else. He must use this year's Madaraka Day to redeem himself. The President must also address the question of youth unemployment. What is the government's agenda for the youth? Do the people in government recognize that Kenya is sitting on a time bomb? Today, there are about 8.5 million unemployed or underemployed young people out there. Does this government care about them? If it does, what is it doing about them? How many young people would the hundreds of billions that have been looted keep in gainful employment? Why does the top continue sit comfortably with the people who have denied our youth livelihood? Why are persons associated with theft from the public coffers still sitting in the cabinet? Why are thieves still running all over the country with cartons and chests of stolen money, lavishly flaunting their loot at public gatherings? Are we proud to display to the world that we are a bandit economy? It is sad that while these individuals in government are conspicuously flaunting their ill-gotten wealth, millions of citizens smart under the oppressive weight of the cost of living. As a nation, we must now embrace our national values as espoused in Chapter 6 of our Constitution, and especially Article 10. We must begin calling thieves by their true name instead of deodorizing theft by calling it corruption. We must ask ourselves about the impact of this theft on the cost of living. The link between theft and the oppressive cost of living is enough cause for us to outlaw the thieves and their associates. The President must also address the ongoing wrangles in the education sector. Kenyans expect persons in cabinet to be their servants and to comport themselves with the requisite humility. We cannot have overbearing individuals barking at Kenyans when they should be explaining government policy. They say that if you want to destroy a nation, target its children. We are hearing frightful things about the new competence-based curriculum that seems to be forced down our throats. The Ministry of Education must sit down with the leaders of the teachers' unions and other stakeholders and listen to their concerns about the curriculum. It is reckless to tell Kenyans that the train has already left the station. Where is this train going? Is there a broken bridge across the valley ahead? So specifically here, the President should direct his Minister for Education to engage in dialogue with the concerned stakeholders, including the teachers and other educationists. Meanwhile, insecurity is back again. We have witnessed troubling incidents of orchestrated insecurity in several parts of the country. Organized criminals and the gangsters are murdering Kenyans in cold blood in the Rift Valley, Western, and northeastern parts of Kenya. Parts of Nairobi and central Kenya remain unsafe as well. The government must step up to the plate. Turning to the regional affairs, our country has traditionally been a leader in regional peace initiatives. This role is now slipping away literally through our fingers. We have our own tiffs with Somalia and Uganda over territorial issues. President Jomo Kenyatta used to underscore the sanctity of our territorial integrity. What seems to have gone wrong? We need to tap established international law forums to correct the question of our territorial integrity without escalating relations with our neighbors. We also need to recapture and resume our role as regional peacemakers. There exists intrastate challenges in Ethiopia, South Sudan, and of course Somalia. Disturbing interstate challenges also exist, for instance, between Rwanda and Uganda. Rwanda and Burundi, Ethiopia and Somalia, Ethiopia and Eritrea, and Ethiopia and Djibouti. There are also issues between Rwanda and Uganda on the one hand and the Democratic Republic of Congo on the other. The latter is coupled up with internal challenges, competing centers of power in the DRC. Without a doubt, both the Horn of Africa and the Great Lakes region continue to be powder kegs. They require a stable Kenya as a regional stabilizing player. Kenya must therefore swiftly put her house in order by addressing all the issues that I have raised above before she can reclaim her leading role in the region. End of statement. Now I would be glad to take some questions. Let me say this because I've been saying it, and I would like to draw the media to some specific country. Right now, the debt issues come under the Public Finance Management Act, where there's supposed to be some inkling or sign of independent debt management. But I can tell you, Kenya, in spite of that act being what it is, the position of who was going to be in charge of debt management remained vacant for almost 1 year. And then it has been set up as a very small unit within the Treasury. And yet debt has become a crisis. Therefore, to set up an independent institution, you would need to look at countries like Ireland, who had a serious debt challenge, very serious debt challenge. Ireland was broke. Through their parliament, through their legislation, and we can do it, this parliament can set up an independent authority that can have teeth to slow down the appetite of the Kenya government when it comes to borrowing. They will be able to evaluate if Kenya Pipeline is borrowing, are we going to get value for that borrowing? If KPLC is borrowing, are we going to get value? If the geothermal organization is borrowing, are we going to get value from those debts that we are incurring? So I am putting this across because Parliament can set up such legislation and they do not have to reinvent the wheel. They can get this from countries that have managed their debt better. Yep, thank you. I did not single out a single person in cabinet. I said, in cabinet, there are people. That means there are more than one. And I don't have to tell you this. You just have to ask yourself who have been regular visitors to Kinoti's office. Do you think Kinoti is making breakfast for them? You know them. How can you have a cabinet where a lot of your officials are regular visitors to the investigative authorities? Surely they're not going there for a joyride. They are being called for serious issues. Yep. I would like to believe that good legislation does not necessarily have to be partisan. Good legislation, and if it is for the good of the country, and indeed we have a crisis of debt, I will have no problem whether such a motion is being promoted or sponsored by an ANC member or an ODM member or a Jubilee member. I would not have a problem. What we want is good legislation to help us tame the debt that is becoming unbearable. That is one issue. And Parliament is the legal way. It's the authorized way. We should not sit back and say that because I don't have a majority in Parliament, then my legislators who are not in the majority party should not bring in any legislation. Everybody is entitled to bring in legislation, especially that which is good for the country. That should be the position. I think it's bearing fruit. I think awareness is beginning to come, because I started talking about this in 2015, all right? And warning and cautioning that this debt is getting out of hand. I think the message is beginning to sink home. Kenyans are beginning to realize that there's a problem. With higher debt, expect higher taxes. This is the message. As simple as that. With higher debt, expect higher taxes. And you have seen that this message is also going to the creditors. Not too long ago, the Chinese government shied away from extending a similar program like the SGR one to Kisumu. That was a signal that clearly even our creditors are beginning to evaluate our books and beginning to realize that they may be going into a very risky affair. The classic example was the area around the dams. That is a classic example. Because when you put too much money in your budget and the absorptive capacity is not there, because programs, there's a lead time between design, feasibility study, design, and the implementation of a project. But when you say that you're putting so much money for so many dams at a go, you're setting up everybody for a gravy train. That is a classic example. And there are others. Some of the parastatals that are there, we know they have inflated their projects. Whether you want to look at the pipeline or others, they have inflated their projects. And they inflate by hiding in the figures. All I can tell you is that we have to communicate, and there's no other way we can communicate to Kenyans about the ills that are affecting our country in a civilized manner other than talking through the media. Don't downgrade the fact that we are talking. It is important. It is the civilized way to communicate. But as pressure mounts, and indeed we have seen it beginning to mount, where the ordinary citizens are getting restless. So what we are saying is that before we fall into a state of disorder, I think the government should address these concerns. Nasema PCP, Pilipilu sio ila. Inakuashia nini? Kwa hivyo hiyo sizungumuzi. Hiyo sihusiki, sijui. Kile mimi nasema, mimi nazungumuza yale ambayo ni ya muhimu sana kwa taifa. Rampant also. It is also, when I talk about this, let me make it very clear that under no circumstances are we underestimating or underrating the corruption in counties. It is serious. And somehow, when we see stories, there's a magical figure around 2 billion shillings. Every time you see a governor is being taken somewhere, the figure is roughly 2 billion. So you wonder whether there was a convention somewhere where they all agreed that if there's embezzlement, it should be within the range of 2 billion. Anyway, that is a different matter. But let me also say this. You know, when we talk of devolution, we want to tell people that we should take devolution seriously, we should embrace it. Our clarion call as ANC is Amani na Ugatuzi, which means we believe in the foundation of devolution. A strong devolved system is absolutely essential. And I don't think we should tamper with it as a Kenyan people. But we should enhance capacity so that the corruption that we are talking about at national level is also dealt with at the county level. And therefore, I also say it is strange that we are hearing of some calls where we see that there are certain governors who have messed up. Their counties are reeling from a lot of questionable issues. And then you hear some sections of the country saying that we need to amend the constitution to reward these governors with another layer of status. You know, governors in some areas have looted. And I mean no ill will. Some of them have looted. And they are there in the court, you see them. But then when you now say, create another layer, again, of super governors, at whose expense? Who pays for it? Are you... I mean, there are some suggestions that are weird. Are you telling us that we reward guys who have been looting some sections of our country with another layer of authority?